Hey guys, welcome or welcome back. Today we're going to do some reconstructive surgery on some highlights in an image that we shot within the bracketing portion of the How to Shoot with Backlight video. Oh my goodness, that was a long intro. I'll see you in a sec. So, like I've just rambled and said, essentially what we're going to do is we're going to look at a situation like we shot in the previous video on how to shoot with backlight, where we used bracketing or a double exposure technique to get a less blown out area of the sky while still exposing well for our subject. Now, in that video, we did not have Bright with us. We had Finn and Piper. What I want to do is use this image and one that kind of doesn't line up, but from Piper's session with Finn, that is this one, which is the background. So I found this shot of Bright, which is exposed really well for her, but obviously this is just horrific. So what we can do is to try and find the same angle, and this is actually the exact same piece of bokeh and sky as is here. So I also took a darker shot, which is this one. So this image is the same section. So just look at this kind of weird shape here, right? So the same as this one. So obviously there's some scale differences, but I think it's going to be a good exercise because it's not going to be that easy. I'm just going to kind of go through what I would do in this situation, because a lot of people have asked how they would put the two together and how you would make it work. So I just want to cover that off in this video. And then we will also be doing a full edit of a backlit sunset kind of image, but I'll come to that in a minute. So what we want to do is open both of our files up in Photoshop. So what we want is we want one with a sky that's just horrifically blown out, and then we want one with the sky not blown out. Now technically that is not blown out, but it's still super bright, so I would prefer to use this one. But this is a really, really dark. However, because of our knowledge that we know about histograms, we know that when we're looking at a histogram, like this one on the screen here, our peaks that are over in the whites and the highlights are much more difficult to pull back data from than the shadows. So actually, we could probably lift the midtones on this image quite substantially and we won't clip anything. Whereas if we were to go ahead and do the same thing with this one, do you see how close that peak is to the right hand side? That peak here is this, right? That's there. So let's go and just look at our highlight peak in this one. Our peak at this bit, well, technically this brightest part is here. So we've got a little bit more room to play here. So what I actually want to do is bring along the darker one. So I'm going to be using this one. And to do that, I want to do a Command A. If I say Command and you're on a Windows, you press Control, okay? If I say Option, you press Alt. And if I say Control, you right click. Stick with me here. So we're going to do Command A, and what that does is it selects all. So Command A selects all of the pixels, we get the matching ants. So when we've done a Command A, we then need to copy everything inside. So we're going to do Command C, C for copy, and then we're going to go to our reference image that we're wanting to work on, and then we're going to do a Command V. Command V will paste. Okay, so looking at these two images here, we can see a massive difference really in the scale of the bokeh. So if you look at the size of this circle here, that is quite substantially larger than the circle that is here. So also, they're not aligned. So this part coming out here is this part coming out here. And what we want to do is try our best to line them up. Using something like auto align would be fine, but it's very unlikely that Photoshop will be able to pick those sections up. So what I want to do is just kind of place it roughly-ish in the right place. And then I'm going to go over to my layers over here and bring the opacity of that top layer down to about 50%. You don't have to be exact here. So with that done, what I want to try and do is line up these bokeh circles as best I can. And there is definitely going to need to be a little bit bigger, because this circle here that we can just see is supposed to be this circle here. So what we can do is get it roughly in the right position, and then we want to do Command T. T for transform. And when we do a Command T, we get our transform controls up around the side, and that means that we can start to change the size of the layer that's up the top. Now, very important, if you do that and it pulls it kind of just wider, but doesn't go bigger on all sides, just go ahead and go back to where it was just have the command controls, and then do the little link there in the middle. So what we want to do is just roughly by eye line them up. So just keep pulling. They're not going to be exactly the same size, but we'll get them kind of roughly-ish. I think it's actually about there. I mean, that's a little high. Let's bring her in a bit. Okay, it'll be about that. Like I said, it's not going to match because these were shot on two different days and they weren't shot in the exact same place. So when we're happy with our transformation, we click the tick. And when that tick is checked, that transformation is locked in. We can then put our layer opacity right back up to 100%. So now what we have is we've got our darker layer sat over the top of the brighter layer with bright. No pun intended. And just looking at the bokeh, they're pretty well aligned. But there's a massive difference and there's still loads of work to do. Okay, so as normal with me, we're going to go ahead and grab a mask. So we go up and do a select subject, which has made a pretty good selection. We don't really need the feet involved, but if we want to expand that selection, we can probably use the lasso tool and just loosely select down here. So to add to a selection, you just hold down shift, and then you want to just kind of loosely go ahead and add your dog in. Okay, so this bit, hold down shift, and we've got a selected. So with that done, what I want to do is go select and mask. If you don't see select and mask, select a mask, okay? We're going to open up select and mask, making sure that we were still clicking on our original dog layer, which we were. And there is a whole video on how to, well, there's two videos on how to mask fur and fluff in Photoshop. So I will link ahead to that above, and I'll meet you back in a sec. Okay, so in our select a mask dialog, I would always, as you guys already know, output to a layer mask. So what that's done is that's put bright's mask over here. What I then want to do is just click, drag, and drop that up onto our dark layer, as it were, and turn that layer on. That will give us this, which looks ridiculous. But don't panic, we just need to invert the mask and change white to black and black to white. To do that, we just need to do a command I. And command I will invert that for us. Now do not panic about any haloing edges that we've got here, because that's mainly because there's an issue with the exposure difference. Those bits are actually her hair. They're not mask gaps. Most of them. There's a couple under here that are. Okay, so we've now got a floating bright in the middle of this shot, and we have our background and the dark bit. Now, as we can see in this one, we've got some foreground that should not be present. Let me turn that off for a sec. What I want to do is kind of darken down the areas around her, not massively, but just darken them a bit so that we kind of end up with a little bit more of an equal exposure between her, because she's super dark, and this kind of greenery around her. So the first thing that I'm going to do, holding with our dark background layer, let me name this bokeh dark, for example. And with our original background layer, which includes bright, we're going to do command J, which is a duplication of the layer. You can also click, drag, and drop down onto the little plus icon down there, or you can right click and do a duplicate layer. Any of the above. There's probably 3,000 more ways because it's Photoshop. With that done, what I want to do is go ahead and grab this mask, and I'm going to copy it this time. So I'm not just going to click, drag, drop. I'm going to hold down option on the keyboard, click, drag, drop. And what that's going to do is copy the layer mask. So now we've got two bright masks, one of which is on our background layer of bright, which is a copy of the background layer. Are you with me? Let's just stick with me here. We also have our dark layer, which is turned off presently. Okay, leave that off. And remember, with layer knowledge, the stack is important. If all of this is foreign to you, there is a Photoshop for Beginners course that's available over on my website. It goes through all of this. You'd be fine following tutorials after that. So with this, what we then want to do is darken down the foreground, right? So we'll go ahead and grab a adjustment layer and we'll go for a curves. Note that that has sandwiched itself between the dark background and our bright layer, which is perfect. Bright as in the dog. So with this curves available, what I want to do is just grab my midtones and darken them. To darken your midtones, you literally just put a pin somewhere in the middle of that curve and you want to just pull to the right hand side. That will just darken your midtones. I mean, it darkens everything, but you see what I mean. So you could either pull right or you could pull down. Either is absolutely fine. So we just want to darken those down. Now notice now how basically we can barely see her because she's so dark and this blown out bit is so obviously blown out. It looks horrific. Don't panic. What we're then going to do is with this curve, what I wanted to do is only affect this layer, the layer immediately below, and not this layer as well, which it currently is. This layer below is ignoring bright because bright is black on the mask, and therefore all we need to do is click this little icon here to create a clipping mask. Ignore the words there, it's confusing. Essentially what that does is it says, hey you layer, only affect the layer below you, ignore everything else. So you can either click that or you can hold down option, hover between the two layers till you see that little icon pop up there, and then just click. So what that's doing now is, if you can see around here, that is giving us a exposure change on the background, but it's ignoring bright because bright is in this layer. Are you with me? It's all to do with your masks, because masks are life. So what that has done for us is it's equalizing off the exposure a little bit and things are looking a little bit more neutral. So you could change the opacity of that layer if you wanted to. So what I'm going to do is I want to add a little bit to this selection. I want to add this part here so that this is a little bit darker as well. So to do that, I'm going to go ahead and grab this mask, the one that's blocking bright, grab a brush by pressing B. We're on 80% opacity for the brush, which is absolutely fine. And I'm just going to go ahead and dot over there. It doesn't have to be exact. It's okay. So what that's going to do is just kind of equalize off the exposure so it looks a lot more natural. So now looking at this, let's look at this so that it's just kind of her. She doesn't look like she's cut out and this is a bit darker, which is fab. So then what we want to do is go ahead and turn on our dark background layer and see where we're at. So here, what I want to do is go ahead with the mask, and I really definitely want to break through because this reed is above ground level, but yet bright sat on it, so she's floating. We don't want that. So I'm going to grab a black brush, and on the mask that's on that dark layer, I'm going to go ahead at 100% opacity. And just go ahead and break through. And it doesn't need to be exact at this stage, it's literally just breaking through, but we're keeping that around her head the same. Okay, so that was too much. We can go 30% maybe, slightly smaller brush, and just dot through. Okay, so we're starting to include areas that were there in the mid-ground, but we still have a mask on the top of her head. Okay, and that's important because this part is super bright here. Okay, so with that now in, we're kind of like looking a little bit more natural, but this is still too dark. I mean, look at the level that we have here in the green and then here, like the two just don't match. But what we can do with that is quite straightforward. We can go ahead and grab another curves adjustment layer. And this time we're going to do the clipping mask thing again, but we're going to do it on that one. So this only affects this, and this only affects this. So with this one, we need to think, okay, what do we need to do to the dark layer to make it blend better with these ones? Well, we need to probably lift the shadows. So the shadows are down here on the histogram. So we need to just lift up the shadows a little bit. And when those shadows are lifted, what we can then do is just kind of bring back the highlights if we wanted to. And that will keep the two kind of level, if that makes sense. So what you could also do, let me go back and just reset that off. We'll go ahead and repeat curves adjustment layer, clipping mask. What you can also do is grab your little hand icon here, click and drag up to lift that particular point. And when you're happy, click on another point and bring that down. And what that does is that will keep the two independent and add a point specifically on the curve for where that sits. Now looking at this, this back bit is probably a little bit too dark still. So what I'm going to go ahead and do is just add a point in the midtones here and just lift that up a bit. Now that is pushing contrast into my highlights, which I don't want. I'll grab my shadow pen and just lift that up a little bit. So you don't want it to be too severe, because you have to obviously make sure that this bit looks realistic. And it might be that we've probably maybe overcooked our foreground darkening. I don't think so. I think that's actually okay. I'm going to give it a tweak. But that gives us a good level of lightness. Our main aim by doing this, by the way, if we're not 100% sure, is basically just to focus the viewer's attention on the lightest part of the image, which is what would happen anyway, and we want that at the end of the edit to be Bright's face. Now, you might notice as well that this area of bokeh is less golden than this area of bokeh. So what we can also do is go ahead, stack another adjustment layer, and this time we'll go for a color balance. And with the color balance on, we're going to clip that to that layer, just like we did before. So again, these are only acting on this. And with this one, what we want to do is add a little bit of yellow and add a little bit of red. And that's pretty balanced now. If you wanted to, you could add a little bit of magenta. So do you see how it's warm? Cool. Warm, cool. And the two just match a little bit better. It could be that you might say, well, Jess, that looks still too dark. Lift our black point and reduce a bit of contrast on that curve. Let's operate in on that layer. So at this stage then, you can flatten these off. What I personally would do, if we're interested, don't know if you are, select all of them by holding down Shift and clicking from the top to the bottom or the bottom to the top. Command G to put them in a group. Command J to duplicate the group and then right-click Merge Group. This is now a background layer that we can go forward and edit on top of. Should we do a full edit? I think so. I'll meet you back next time. If you haven't already, guys, please do remember to press the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Man, it helps me out so much, and I really, 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 really appreciate it. I'll see you all again really, really soon.